All right, we are back. And there has been some discussion, although I don't think that it's gotten to consensus. Do you guys want to still discuss it, or?
Well, we could do both of them, basically split the party.
Okay.
I'm on the side of getting of hiring somebody to look through these notes, personally.
Yeah. It's not a bad idea.
Yeah, but considering how much stuff is in that basement, if we do not have the locate object, basically finding those notes will be nigh on impossible.
Tinkerno might be able to find the notes of that guy by looking through the crates. Once we find the right crate, presumably all the stuff will be there.
Well, I can start looking through the sky myself with my spyglass and start marking off areas where it's not if I can't find it.
That's true.
So I can do that while you guys try to find these notes and such.
Okay. Do you want to
Hey,
do that?
Gibbous.
Hold on. Do you
Sorry.
want to do that from your ship, or do you want to leave town and go to one of the hills nearby?
I'll go to one of the hills nearby.
Okay.
I think you shouldn't go alone. Well,
Leva will go with.
Old did mention that there are some creatures.
Yep,
Oh, is
Leva
there?
will go with you.
Oh, okay.
So I think Leva and possibly Braxton or Okkar.
Well, leave it up to other people. If other people want to go, then they can. If it's just Leva and Hagamus, it's just Leva and Hagamus. It's
Don't we have a second spyglass?
No, that was
Yeldon has one.
that was Yeldon's,
That's
and he
Yeldon's
took it.
Oh, what a pity. Okay.
Now, when I was talking about gnomes being good at precision instruments, I probably should have mentioned also they're good at glassware too, like making really good lenses, making really good glasses, that sort of thing. So, if you
Oh.
want to buy another one, you could buy another one here pretty easily.
How much?
Okay.
It's 1,000. Right.
Let me think
I
about
didn't say it was cheap. I just said it was available.
Yeah, they're always expensive.
Yeah.
Before you go, Higamus, they had those charts in the library. Do you think it would be worth you looking through those charts of that area and then going to look at the stars, see if you can.
See anything new? Compare it.
Yeah, because they've got down what they've seen. And they might. Well, mind you, it's written in, the notes would be written in Tinkerno.
Some of the descriptions of objects and stuff would be written in Tinkernome, but star charts still use fairly standard descriptions of items and stuff like that. I mean, like symbology. That's what I'm looking for. So,
Right.
you may not always know exactly what the object is unless you compare it with your own stuff, but you'd at
I
least
see.
have a basis to start from.
So
Right.
Higamus could look at their chart and see if something was a size A Earth body or something.
Perhaps.
All right. Well, I can try that. I mean, I'll do that
Okay.
so I can get that started.
All right. So you go. Do you have a notebook, or would you be taking some sheets of paper to just make some notes based on what you're seeing there? Or are you going to go from
Hagamus
your
does have a
memory?
little notebook,
Okay.
yeah.
All right. So you take some notes and then head with Leva outside of town to one of the hills. Okay. All right, and the rest of the party, keep in mind that it is now night. The
Back, sorry. I
it's
have to
okay.
do stuff.
The town is there's still a decent bustle, but it's pretty clear that at night things ha are not as active.
Yeah.
Can't believe I'm gonna say this, but I think Ocker's gonna try to find a ticket down the tavern to hire some people.
You would probably have better luck going to a specific college of something. Like,
then I'll do that.
Well, but you'd need to think of the college that might be relevant.
God. What are the different colleges?
There's colleges for just about everything.
College of Finding Notes.
Braxton might go to this place that studies poems and carrots.
Okay.
So Lars will go and inquire at the librarian about the deceased researcher and ask if there is if he knows any friends of his.
Okay.
Oh, these are about ships.
I think I'll go with Solas, actually.
If the notes are going to be... Citadels are ships, right?
Yeah.
Is there, like, a college dedicated to, like, ship stuff?
There's colleges dedicated to, like, stonemasonry, carpentry, shipwrights, that kind of thing. But, I mean, if you're talking about finding someone who can translate the notes, you wouldn't need something related to ships to do that.
I thought we would because it's ship-related.
It's astronomy-related.
Oh, then, I guess, is there, like,
Well, you're at the College of Astronomy, but... Like, I mean, if you just want someone to translate stuff for you, that's... That doesn't require really specialized knowledge.
Okay, I guess a college for people that translate stuff? I imagine there's something like that, or how?
Okay. You return to the Harbor Master's office and take a look at the map. You do find a listing for a college of literary arts and etymology.
That I will go there.
And entomology.
Isn't that a study of insects?
They're both, there's one letter difference. It's clearly similar enough, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, no. Okay, I'm going.
Okay, so you are doing that. And I think that's pretty much everyone. All right, so... Ocker, you, you go to the college to inquire about someone willing to translate, and you do find someone willing to do so. A dwarf that, I mean, not a dwarf, a gnome. I'm sorry, that
is half breed.
You. She introduces herself to you, and you only pick up the shorter version of her name as Vikna, but she is willing to do translation for 6 silver pieces per hour.
Aww.
I will happily pay that.
Okay.
It's actually probably really expensive. But you only own a go today or something. Or less.
So, I guess I'll bring her with me to where all the notes are.
Okay.
I think you'd have to arrange a date, though, wouldn't you?
Do I?
No, she's willing to do it right now.
Okay. Oh.
Like, that. I would assume that was, you know, one of the things of we need someone right now to do some translation.
Yeah, right now.
Kind of thing. So,
we found somebody who had an off day from their normal research.
Alright, so she begins working, reading over the boxes. You give her the name Gneb, and she gets to work. And Solas and Laftel, so you return to the library and ask about the deceased gnome astronomer. What information are you specifically looking for?
Is there any friend of his who knew him well in this college?
He does mention a few that he thinks were pretty friendly with him.
Are they in here, this college still?
One of them, he thinks, made enough money with his work here that he went to pursue his life quest more vigorously to build the perfect toothpick. And you might be able to find
the plane of Earth
elsewhere. I'm sorry?
In like the plane of elemental Earth or something.
No. The problem. So the librarian goes into some detail. The problem that he kept having with trying to build the perfect toothpick is that they're not portable. I mean, you know, you just can't get the hamster into the mouth. So that's what he's working on.
Of course, it's powered with hamsters.
Yeah.
What about the rest of his friends?
He mentions one that he thinks is still working. He's studying a specific constellation in the night sky, and you might be able to find him in one of the laboratories.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to go talk to him?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh.
Okay. So you get some directions and find this other gnome. His shortened form of his name comes out to be Udor.
Huh.
And he tells you, "Ah, yes. Gneb was a pretty good friend of mine. He made some fantastic tomato soup. Let me tell you, it's such a shame what happened to him. But you know." For every step forward, there have to be two steps back, right?
Yes, that's what I have heard.
What can I tell you about Gneb?
Do you remember any specific, like how his notes looked like or something like that to help us locate them?
Yeah, that's what I was going
to
ask.
Well, his notes did tend to have tomato stains on them. He liked his tomato soup, let me tell you. It was his life quest. Did I tell you that?
We have heard about it.
Pursued tomato soup with a passion.
Did he have like pictures of tomato soup on his book covers or something like that? Now that you mention it.
No. It just tended to be stains on the papers.
Did he like tomato? Did he particularly look? Did he... I'm trying to figure the right book. Did these books or things that he was keeping notes in, did they stand out at all? They just had tomato stains on them, nothing else. They didn't have, like, a certain, like, embroidery on them or something.
Nothing that I can think of.
Tomato stains does narrow it down, but you need something that could smell tomato. Very distinctively. Do you know such a creature? I mean, you know anything, surely.
Oh, well, I mean, if you go over to the Advanced Hamster Genetics Laboratory, you might be able to find a specialized breed that can smell tomato soup.
Sounds like an adventure. That sounds like something we could pursue. Yeah. Should we do that, Silas, I guess?
Did he tell you much of his research?
Which?
A bit. Was there a specific thing that you were wondering about?
Yeah, we are looking for this dwarven citadel. And I give him the description.
I didn't pay much attention to the specifics of his work. I'm pretty focused on my own study of this constellation. He points you to a chart of stars that he has up on a board. Neither of you are particularly familiar with the constellations of Brawl Space, but it doesn't look like any of the ones that you're familiar with. In fact, now that you're looking at it, you think it's incorporating half of one and half of another that's in the zodiac in this sphere.
Does it look like a hamster?
It does not look like a hamster. Then again, he hasn't drawn out an image over it, so you're not sure what it's supposed to be. It could be anything from a candle to a Snarkleblack. On the other hand, Snarkleblacks are invisible, so...
I'm looking at my spell memory read, and I was thinking the same intensity as the subject, which would indicate if he wasn't paying attention, then yeah, he wouldn't have very good memories of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we got the knowledge of tomatoes, the tomato soup stains.
We now need to find a hamster that can
detect the old tomato soup stains.
Yeah.
Dominic, you could ask Oka to bring Beowulf to smell.
Beowulf isn't trained, though.
You'd have to speak for animals or something.
Yeah, but we also have to rest for the locate object, or have you memorized it?
I have not memorized either of the spells.
Yeah.
Isn't there a mage version of locate object as well? Pretty sure there is.
I don't think it's commonly available.
Oh.
Yeah. And not that I have researched it, even if there is.
Alright, so do you have more questions for him, or are you going to listen to his advice?
Not at the moment. So I think we are going to listen to his advice.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Alright, it is night, however, and it does appear that that college has essentially closed for the night. There's a very large stable-like building nearby that is the doors are closed off, the and there's a fenced-off area attached to that that's full of a field that has a field in it. And there are no animals out there. Clearly the animals are asleep at this time.
Well, I think it's time for us to retire for the night so we can memorize the spell as needed.
Okay.
Yeah, it seems so. We catch up with the rest, or try to find the rest of the party. We didn't really have a meetup place.
Well,
Ocker's still awake, and he's hired the gnome to start translating.
Actually, no. We go back to the.
Can't we go sleep in the shuttle?
Yeah, or you can go.
Yeah, no.
Rent a room.
I want to go back to where Ocker is, because if she's looking for pages, if she's got like 50 books and one of them has tomato stains on it, it narrows it down drastically.
Okay.
So I want to relay that information.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a good idea, but I think Solas will go to sleep so he can change his spells.
Alright. So Solas heads to the ship, and Laftel, you head to see Ocker and his hire?
Yeah.
Okay. They have made a little progress. She's done with the first shelf. and when I say shelf, I don't mean the entire bookshelf. I'm talking about just the one flat surface that has boxes on it. And she's on the second one. She seems to get distracted easily, thinking about the origins of the names and words that are on the pages.
I noticed that. Don't look up and say, "Figured anything out?"
We spoke to one of his colleagues or friends, and the only thing we really learned is that was unique about his books was that they had tomato stains on it. After all, it was his life quest, and so we're gonna hire out a magnificent hamster to smell out the book, but the stables are closed right now, so we'll have to do that in the morning. But okay, maybe if you find any books with tomato stains, it'll narrow it down drastically.
Yeah, I look over at the Tigger Gnome and tell her, see if there's a clue. See if there's look for anything with tomato stains, I guess.
Oh, I haven't found anything like that yet.
Now, well, hopefully that helps.
Have I told
you
about the origin of this word here? She starts going in to a spiel about the etymology of a word. Apparently it's from Dwarvish. Okay.
Thank you.
She's going to keep going on and wasting time.
I mean, you hired someone who studies etymology.
But it was the best idea I had, so I'm just gonna put up with it.
She's not going to stop now.
I thank you for your explanation, but can you please keep looking?
Oh, yes, of course.
Don't lose your mind, Ocker.
He's going to lose some sleep, put it that way.
It'll be fine. It's not like I had to prepare spells or anything. It'll be fine. Yet.
All right, so, Laffle, are you going to return to the ship to get some rest?
Is there any good inns nearby or something?
Right off the dock, there is a large dormitory-style building that you can rent rooms.
Is it, like, decent, I suppose?
Oh, yeah, it's fine. I mean, it's not poor quality.
I'll go for that.
It's not fantastic, but...
Yeah, I'd rather sleep on a bed than on the shuttle, on the hammock, or whatever. Or okay. Being cramped. It fits within my researching spells, praying for spells elsewhere, so...
It's 8 gold if you don't mind sharing a room with others, and
Jesus.
If you want a... I mean, 8 silver, I'm sorry. 8 silver.
8 gold?
Yeah, no,
I'll get back to the shuttle.
I misspoke. However, it is 4 gold if you want a private room.
No, I have 4 gold, I want my own room.
Oh, but 8 gold is too much, I see. Alright.
It's the hyperinflation.
Okay,
he's,
and
he's deducted the full good off.
Higgamus and Leva. So you leave Port Walkaway and walk out to one of the nearby hills. How long do you think you're gonna spend? Are you gonna like be all night?
Yeah, I'll go all night.
Okay.
Fun.
Leva's getting her time out of Higgamus. She does that with a lot of people lately.
Okay, so you set yourselves up on the hill and start observing the sky. Higgamus, are you going to start by picking out the obvious objects that you can see with the naked eye and looking at those to, like, confirm or dismiss them, and then you move on to the empty space in between kind of thing?
Yeah. I'm particularly looking for anything that has like a looks like it's kind of like reflecting light as opposed to emitting itself.
Okay. Since you are in an asteroid belt, there's a lot of that.
Yeah. do I know about the size of what a citadel is? I guess I wouldn't be able to tell that, would I? No.
It would be difficult to tell. Citadels are normally... I mean, they're the smallest ones are 300 tons. The largest ones that can be moved by forge power are 700, and anything bigger than that can't be moved by forge power at spell jamming speed. Mm-hmm. There are some that are larger, but... Not too many. But you begin to look, taking notes, conversing with Leva, you know, just letting her know what you're seeing, stuff like that, and generally keeping each other awake. After about 3 hours, you do hear some large rustling in the grass. The grass is pretty long around here, not like... arm height or shoulder height or anything like that, but more like halfway up a human shin. I mean, thigh. So not
do we
quite
both hear it?
Haste height, waist height. You do both hear it, and after a few minutes, you know, given that it's nighttime, you do see a group of large furry creatures. Moving slowly, they're not moving fast. They seem to be grazing on the grass. But they're at the bottom of the hill. And
is there a group of what?
Large, roundish, furry creatures.
But they eat the grass.
They're eating the grass. They seem to be ignoring you for now, though.
A bit. Yeah, Lever relaxes a little bit.
Go ahead and both of you give me an intelligence check. Okay, you do recognize, both of you do recognize them as hamsters.
Yeah, okay.
About the size of a small bear.
Oh. Yeah. I'll leave them alone.
Okay.
Are they harmless?
As far as you know.
Okay. So we wait.
I mean, they don't seem to be... I mean, they're pretty loud, munching on the grass and stuff like that, but... They don't seem to be really paying any attention to you. There's about a dozen of them.
Do they get closer?
They eventually move off, just browsing the grass.
Okay.
You stop your observations as the sun begins to rise, night sky starts to get, pink with dawn. And I assume head back to the ship.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Did you see anything, Higamus?
He has not identified anything, any citadels yet.
Okay.
But at the very least, he's started to take notes of what he has seen so that he can, he started to eliminate objects.
Well, that's good.
Braxen, leaving the College of Astronomy and Soup Preparation Studies, you head towards, first you head to the docks to check the map and see where the location of this, the College of Poetry Studies and Carrot Growing is. And then you make your way to that building. It is not a very big building. In fact,
it's probably closed, isn't it?
I'm sorry?
It's probably closed.
It's pretty dark as you're getting there, and it looks like the other buildings around it have now been built up above it, kind of thing, as in like.
Oh.
Almost as if. It's now in the way of these other buildings that have been expanding, and it has not expanded.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's pretty dark. There is an atrium that you go in, the door is open. But there is a sign hanging there. Unfortunately, it's in Tinker Gnome, and there's no one at the desk.
Yeah. Brax is going to see if he can find someone to tell him what time this place opens, so he can work out when to come back. And then get some sleep.
Unfortunately, you're not able to find anyone, and the doors are mostly locked.
Right.
And since you can't read Tinker Gnome, you can't read the sign, which does have some numbers on it, but they're in a different numeral system than you're familiar with.
Brax is going to have a quick look around the street, see if there's any Tinker Gnomes around.
There are actually quite a few moving about. There's also a patrol of Giffen humans down the street. If you want to just stop a random person, you can do so.
Yeah. He's going to say, "Greetings, I'm looking for someone who can read a Tinker Gnome sign to me to let me know when a certain building opens."
Is stopping a gnome?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, I really must be off, but I suppose if it doesn't take much time, what sign do you need to read?
Braxton says, "It's just over here," and shows him the sign.
Oh, yes, that does say that the college is closed for the evening. Please come back at dawn tomorrow, and there are many, many people available here who can help you with your poetry and carrot-growing needs.
Thank you very much. Have a very lovely night.
No problem.
Brax is going to go back and go to bed.
Okay.
And tell the crew to wake him up just before dawn.
Okay. So you awake just as Higamus and Leva get back. Solas is still asleep. Ocker has not returned. And Laftel left a note that he is sleeping in a real bed. So do you want to, like, right away get a quick breakfast and then go to the College of Poetry Studies and Character?
If Higamus comes back, he'll ask him, let him know that Laftel's gone off somewhere.
All right, I'm going to go get some sleep. Get some sleep, so I'll be ready to go for the nighttime.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, back. Sorry, I had to do something.
That's okay. All right, so Braxton, after a quick breakfast, you make your way to the College of Poetry Studies and Carrot Growing. Yeah. And you find an older bearded gnome with glasses sitting behind the desk, and he appears to be either writing or copying from another book. You're not sure what. As you enter,
Braxton says, in Tinker Gnome, "Hello, excuse my Tinker Gnome, it's not too good. I'm looking for advice on a poem relating to something in the sky."
Without looking up or stopping his writing, the gnome says, "Oh yes, if you have a poem that you wish studied, we can certainly help you with that. We have many, many, many fine students here in this facility who would be more than happy to help you out. What sort of poem is it?"
"It's a poem about what we believe to be a dwarven citadel. So it's relating to astronomy rather than carrots. Do you have anyone here that specializes in the sky?"
"Oh, no. I don't believe anyone specializes in anything other than carrots, but we would certainly be interested and willing to help you out. Do you have the poem with you right now?"
"I've memorized it."
"Well, please do... tell it to me."
"Okay. Stony home of Anvil's people you seek. Long last and taken from ruins debris. From forge to spiral it has fled. Small builders on a piece of iron must you speak. For in night sky there they see that which you seek aglow with another sun's shed."
Hmm. Very interesting. Very interesting. Has a note of prophecy about it. Quite interesting.
We think the fourth line refers to the Tinker Gnomes of Iron Peace.
Yes. I think that you should speak with... He seems to be looking at a slate. You notice that slate is actually quite empty. yes. He reads off a name that's very long. You pick up the first part of it as Denid.
Denid.
D-E-N-Y-D.
Y-D. Okay.
And he directs you to a room that you could go to. He points to one of the doors leading off the atrium.
Okay.
So you follow his directions. You notice that there is quite a bit of dust around.
Right. Looks like they're not doing too much here.
But you get to the door and knock on it. And a voice from inside calls, "Come in."
So Braxton goes in and says, "Hello, I'm looking for a poetry expert called Dened."
"Ah, yes, yes, that is me. I'm really much more of an expert on growing carrots, as you can see, and you do see all around the room are a variety of planters with some sort of plant inside. You don't know carrots, so whether they're actually
Braxton
carrots
doesn't
or
not. Know carrots. So they didn't have carrots on his asteroid?
Probably not, no. Not every farming asteroid grows everything.
That's true.
And there are lights around the room.
Oh, so artificial lights.
Yeah, there are different types. You see some that are clearly fire, some that you think might be magic. You don't know. Not being a spellcaster. But there is also two shelves of books. They're not, like, placed neatly on it. They're just kind of haphazardly placed. And there are tables around with papers and open books scattered everywhere.
Braxton never heard of a carrot?
No, you've heard of a carrot. You've just never seen one growing.
Oh, right.
And okay. Since they're in the ground, all you see is the tops.
Yeah.
For all you know, these could be potatoes.
Right.
The gnome that greets you has stark white hair pulled back in a ponytail, and she's wearing pretty thick glasses. She peers up at you and says, "Yes, you need a poem analyzed. I'd be more than happy to help you. It probably doesn't have anything to do with carrots, though, does it? They never do have anything to do with carrots.
Nah,
it's a shame that they never have anything to do with carrots. Carrots are a fascinating subject if you want to know more about them. There are so many different varieties that have so much nutritional value." She keeps going
if
on.
"If we can solve..." Braxton interrupts and says, "If we can solve our problem, and you could recommend some carrots that grow on ships, maybe we'd be interested in getting some."
Oh, she immediately starts talking about and pointing out the varieties of carrots and how easily they would be able to grow on ships. Although you're pretty sure that from some of the descriptions, she is telling you that you need devices and irrigation and stuff like that, and you're not exactly sure that she has any real experience with growing these carrots on ships.
Yeah. Yeah, we would kind of need carrots to take care of themselves.
That sets her off on another tangent about the carrots that need very little maintenance, just watering half a dozen times a day.
Okay, right. Well, Braxton will listen to her for a bit. And I say, "Well, I better get on with our quest. If we could solve it, though, I might come back and see some carrots. But I think we would need carrots with less maintenance than you're referring to. We need idiot-proof carrots."
That sets her off on another lengthy discussion about how completely idiot-proof all of these carrots are. Even her cousin... who has a very black thumb, couldn't kill these carrots, except for a few dozen times that he did it. But they otherwise never die.
Okay, so Braxton's going to read out the poem to her.
All right. Go ahead and read it.
Okay, so the poem is... Didn't think you'd want me to keep reading it.
Sure.
The poem is... "Stony home of Anvil's people you seek. Lost long and taken from ruins debris. From forge to spiral it has fled. Small builders on a piece of iron you must speak. For in night sky there they see that which you seek aglow with another's sun's shed."
She kind of looks at you for a moment and adjusts her glasses and then says,
So I'm
have you
sure
already
the...
spoken with the beavers?
Who?
Have you already spoken with the beavers?
The beavers? No, we've come to speak to Tinker Gnomes. Are they talking beavers?
Yes, clearly you want to speak with the beavers.
Why would I want to speak to beavers?
A beaver's build.
Beaver's build.
I mean, you know, what good are dams and lodges when you could be building a better carrot? But yes, they do build.
So Tinker Gnomes don't build things.
Tinker Gnomes manufacture things.
Ah.
That's clearly what this poem indicates. I'm surprised you didn't know it.
Well, I suppose it's also been translated, so I'm saying it in common.
You got it in common.
I got it in common, yeah.
But yes. Clearly, the beavers are the ones that you'd want to speak to. We have some contact. They're a very good source of wood, but they're not very inventive. They have no interest in building devices powered by hamsters to do all the things that they normally do. They could cut so many more trees if they had some of our devices, but they just show no interest in it. All they want to do is build their dams and lodges, and that's it. But yes, that's clearly what you would want to who you'd want to speak to. They live on the other side of Iron Peace.
They live on the other. Are you talking about regular beavers or beavers that talk?
Oh, they talk. We trade with them. They're a very good source of wood.
Wood is good. Okay. Maybe I'll go see the beavers. And maybe I'll come back later and talk to you about carrots.
Oh, yes, please do. The carrots here are wonderful. In fact, this one right here tastes like beef.
A carrot that tastes like beef?
Don't mind the blood.
It's a steak.
It gets a little bloody when you cut it, but don't mind that.
So it's like some form of mandrake?
I mean, you don't have to look at it. She's just pointing to one that's growing.
Yeah. Braxton will go take a look at it.
Also, Braxton is the only one here, so... I mean, well, yeah. It's in the ground, so she's not picking it. She says it's not ready yet.
Yeah. So, do you ever sell carrots at market?
What? No, I don't have time for that. I have to test out all different types of breeds.
Right. So, we're not going to be able to test carrots on our spelljamming ship to see how well they grow.
That is a fascinating new subject that I could get in. I could start investigating. Scaver flavored carrots. Oh, I haven't thought of that. That would be a fascinating subject to experiment with.
She starts asking you all kinds of questions about how you think that would work.
Braxton
some of it, quite a bit of which is over your head.
Braxton will have a chat with her.
You try to have a chat with her, but number one, she's excited and speaking faster than you can really handle. And every time you start to answer, she's already off on another question. Because unlike the gnomes, who can talk and respond to each other at the same time, you can't.
Yeah. Braxton will say, please slow down, I can't keep up, every so often.
And she starts to do that, but it only lasts...
Yeah, it only lasts a couple of minutes, and then she'll speed up again. Okay. Well, I guess this is dead end, but Braxton will be quite polite about it. And seeing as she hasn't got any carrots to sell us, I guess he'll leave.
Okay.
And he'll thank her very much.
Oh, yes, if you ever have any other poems, prophetic verses, anything like that, please do come to me. I do so enjoy hearing about them. Not as much as carrots, mind you. She's continuing to stop as you slowly close the door, and you're not even sure if she quite realized that you've left.
Well, Braxton, as a counterpoint, says, if you ever get into the business of selling carrots for people to eat on spell jamming chips, get in touch with me.
She is still talking about carrots as you close the door.
Okay.
All right, where do you go from there?
Brack's going to go back to the ship.
Okay. Are you going to let everyone else know that what you discovered? I imagine that Laftel's back, Higgamus and Leva are probably asleep. Ocker, you probably would have come back. Number one, the gnome would need to get some sleep, and you were up all night, so you'd probably be back
okay,
in the sleep.
Okay, go ahead. How much progress did we make before we had to go to sleep?
You got through half of the full shelf.
Oh, no.
There's many, 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 many more shelves to go.
But if we if the information gets passed on that we're looking for books with soup on, we could all go down there.
Yeah, and I've got locate objects. I mean, it would be a bit of a guess. There might be 15 books of tomato soup on, you know. It might just be one.
Oh, so yeah, locate anything with soup on it.
I don't think that would work.
Wouldn't it?
I don't think so. Like, the spell is designed for two things. Number one, find me this very specific object that I am picturing in my head. You know, this diamond ring with the specific cut of the diamond on it. It's surrounded by these. You know, I'm picturing it perfectly in my head. Or find me the closest ladder. You know, there's no in between. But
what if I said find me the closest tomato sauce?
Tomato soup.
Probably wouldn't find. No, a tomato soup stain would not be an object.
Find me the nearest tomato stain.
The best you could do, unless you've seen the book and can the specific book and can picture it in your head, or a specific page that you have seen, like you would have to have seen the page with the soup stain on it to find that. Otherwise, your best bet is find me the nearest book. Which would probably just overwhelm you with pings on in that room.
Yeah, but then we just take each one out of the room. As we find it.
The smell doesn't last that long.
You don't understand how many books there are in that room.
Oh! Can we train Tayin? Can Leva train Tayin to find soup?
We already found out what we need to do with Laftel. We go to the hamster breeding laboratories and rent a hamster that is trained to sniff out the tomato soup.
No, to speak of animals in case it might be necessary, I don't know.
I'm not sure taking a giant space hamster in that room.
Borrowing.
I mean, they might have a miniature giant space hamster who can do it. You haven't actually talked to any of them yet because they were closed. So while Braxton is off talking, is that something that you and Solas want to do, Laftel?
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, I do.
Okay. So you make your way to the College of Advanced Hamster Breeding and Hamster Genetic Studies. In the atrium, you see about a half dozen gnomes rushing around, mostly carrying large piles of some sort of grass or grain or something like that.
Is there any receptionist or something like that in there?
Yeah, there is a desk. Unfortunately, there is no gnome behind the desk.
Is there any bells or something to ring?
No, there isn't. There's just gnomes rushing in and out of the room.
Well, I try to stop one of the gnomes and ask if there is anyone we could talk about getting help with a hamster.
We need to hire a hamster, a specific one.
Oh yes, you'll have to wait. It's feeding time, and they get ornery when they're not fed properly. Well, at least the more aggressive breeds do. You'll have to excuse me. Hold on. Someone will be with you in after feeding time. Mm-hmm. And then he's off.
How long's feeding now? Could I make an educated guess at how long this would take? We took like an hour, 2 hours, half a day.
You really don't know. You don't know giant space hamsters.
No, how many space hamsters they have.
Yeah. How long are you willing to wait?
Hour so far. See what happens.
Okay. As the hour winds down, everything does seem to calm down a bit, and the gnomes aren't rushing around quite so much, and there are fewer of them moving through with armloads of that grass or grain or whatever it was.
Alpha.
It might have been. I'm not sure that either of you know alfalfa.
Nope.
Finally, one does take a seat behind the desk, and starts taking notes in a book in front of him.
Leva could know alfalfa.
Yeah, but you're asleep.
You're asleep.
Oh, okay.
We flag down the we go over to the gnome.
Okay.
Ask. Greetings, could you trouble us for an inquiry? We would like to potentially hire out a hamster, one that's trained in looking for a tomato soup, of all things.
Okay. We have a number of different types of space hamsters that have been bred with advanced olfactory skills. You said tomato is what you're looking for? I'd have to
stains on a book.
Look to see if we have anything like that. There are many different types. They're very good at finding nuts and bolts or grease or the occasional lost gnome.
Well, we are looking for a book in basement of a library that has tomato soup stains.
Yeah,
is this a fresh stain? Day old? 2 days
not,
old?
A couple of years old.
Hydrodynamics. Well, unfortunately...
Think of it this as a challenge for research.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, unfortunately... Billy, the hamster that was very skilled at finding old scents, had an unfortunate accident when... he encountered a wild... Well, let's not dwell on that. It was not a pretty sight, let us say. Unfortunately, we do not have any hamsters on hand right now. We are, of course, training new ones and breeding new ones who have even better olfactory skills. But the smells of that age, unfortunately, I don't think that we can help you with that at the moment. Now, unless, of course, you were talking about buried bodies, that would be something completely different. We definitely have a giant space hamster who can handle that.
Unfortunately, we are not at the moment looking for any bodies.
That is unfortunate. Well, if you're ever looking for buried bodies, we can certainly help you with that.
We'll keep that in mind.
It's very helpful when a building has collapsed.
I think so. Well... That didn't work out.
Yeah, maybe that dwarven sister have been buying wood from the beavers. The beavers did have cheap wood.
Well, we could visit the beavers.
Actually, I'm not sure that either of you would know about that because you would have left.
All right. Yeah, well, regardless, we would come back to the party.
Okay.
Find that afterwards.
So, returning to the ship, Higgamus and Leva are asleep, as is Ocker.
But Braxton is there, and you exchange information. He tells you about the beavers.
Talking beavers. How interesting.
Yeah. I don't know if they mean some sort of beaver people. Or normal size beavers. Mind you, you can talk to animals, can't you, Raftel?
I can, and I do have the spell memorized, but I...
did have a conversation with the crow a while ago.
The gnome said they were talking to them anyway, but they might be using a strange device. Wouldn't put it past them.
Well, we could always go and ask about them.
Yeah.
I think if they are trading with them, there must be someone who knows about them, like a harbor master might know, or...
Well, I was wondering if it was a red herring, because the poetry expert was saying...
Well, you never know.
Gnomes build things. She said they construct things.
Oh, dear.
Well, Solas goes to visit the...
So, hang on. So, you say this book has tomato stains on it. So, would it help if we got some of our crew to go down and look for any items that have tomato stains on?
It would take days and days, I would say.
That would be a conservative estimate.
Yeah.
Okay, so just so you guys know, Ald's put out a lot of hints that going through and searching for that guy's work is going to be super long.
Yeah.
Give us a different point to go look, check out these beavers.
Yeah, that's why Solas was going to visit the harbor master's office to inquire about them.
Okay.
Well, we can go talk to the beavers. I thought that was just something all made up on the spot, because I had a crazy idea. But yeah, let's go talk to beavers.
All right. Well, Solas is going to speak to going to the harbor master's office to see what they have. Do the other two of you want to go along?
Yeah, Braxton, go along.
Okay. All right. You find a pair of gnomes talking inside there. Braxton, it sounds like they're discussing shipments or moving of cargo into one of the warehouses or something like that.
They're speaking in Tinkerbell. So Lars will interrupt them with the common. Could I bother one of you for a moment?
Yes, just a moment. We need to iron out the details here. And he immediately goes back to discussing with the other one. After about 2 minutes, they appear to come to an agreement or something. They both kind of nod their heads, emphasized with words. Braxton, you recognize it as a Tinker Gnome phrase for "that sounds good, we'll do that" kind of thing. And one of them rushes struck. Off. What was that, Laftel?
Yeah, my deal had been struck or something.
They'd agreed on a plan. On how to store stuff. They were talking really fast. Braxton was only able to pick up some of it.
Both are officials of this harbor master's office.
The one who you spoke to a few minutes prior turns back to you and says, "Now, what can I help you with?"
"Yes, I heard that there are you tinker gnomes buy wood from the some beavers on the other side of this asteroid.
Planet.
Yes, we do. They have fine wood products. Fine grain. They know exactly how to get the best wood, and when we need quality wood for precision carpentry, they are the best source in the area for us to speak with."
Could you tell us where we could find them and how to go to them?
He kind of blinks at you for a moment and then says, "They're everywhere on the underside."
Do they have any settlements, so to speak?
Oh yes, just look for the big piles of logs.
I see.
If you just land in one of the rivers, they'll usually come out to greet you. Or if you go sail near one of their lodges, they'll usually come out and speak with you.
And do they speak common or?
Yes, they do.
Okay.
They're not particularly bright. They certainly are uninterested in most of our products. Occasionally they buy some glass or hardware, but they're not very interesting or inventive. They're not even interested in automatic tooth pullers. The nerve.
That's a shame. What do they usually buy from you?
Oh, well, like I said, occasionally glass, tools, metal objects. You'd probably want to speak to the Dowar about what they tend to purchase. They will oftentimes give our merchants looking for wood a list. The Dowar will supply it, and we just cart it over to them.
I see. Well, does either of you have any questions?
No, it seems like we just need to go over.
Are these regular beavers that talk? Are they big? Like giant space hamsters?
They're not as big as giant space hamsters, but they are larger than gnomes.
They're larger than gnomes. Okay. And will they be able to talk to us, or do they talk a special language?
He did tell us that they speak common.
Yeah.
They speak common. Yeah. Okay, sorry. Thank you very much for your help.
You mentioned that the Dowars do business with them. Do you know any specific Dowar that would do business with them?
The Dowar have a consortium. Any of them that you talk to will be able to share their questions around.
Okay, thank you.
Well, basically, you would know that most Dowar are essentially agents of a larger merchant consortium.
Yeah. Well, we can either go ask more information about these beavers from Dowar, or we can just try directly going to the beavers.
I go back and wake up Higgamus, see what he thinks.
Yeah, I think he has had time to sleep at least somewhat.
We could fly using a ship or something.
Yeah.
We can carry on sleeping.
Well, I mean, you might want to confirm with the captain taking the ship out of port and everything like that.
Yeah, I think it's better to confirm with the captain.
Yeah. Well, we've got some... areas of areas of investigation on this side, so we can see how everyone's getting on with that.
Well, everyone else is asleep right now.
Yeah.
Okay, so you return to the ship. Do you want to wake them up or not? It's noonish now.
Yeah, so last we'll go and get someone to wake Higgamus up.
Brat's gonna say, I'm not sure that's a good idea. You might want to look at the stars again tonight.
Well, Solas already kind of indicated that he was gonna do that.
Fair enough. Okay. Yeah.
Alright, Higgamus, someone, one of the crew wakes you up. Says that Solas wanted to talk to you. You've gotten maybe 5 hours sleep.
Nah, that's not terrible. Okay, I'll get dressed and ready, and then I'll go out to meet Souls.
Well, I basically relay the information that we got from Braxton's sources and the harbor master.
Oh, okay. So we need to get
go to the other side and basically. They said that we could basically just land in one of their, just land in the water there and basically sail near one of their lodges or dams, and they should come and talk with us.
All right, sounds good.
But we might also get information from Dover about the beavers before we go there. If you think that would be good.
Okay, that sounds good. Make it so then.
Well, do you mean make it so going there or talking to the Doar?
Well, he just mentioned to me the Doar. Speak with them about what information they can give us about the beavers.
Okay. So, Solas, you going to go out and find some Doar?
Yeah, I will go and inquire about the beavers from Doar.
Okay.
Since they seem to have most contact with the beavers.
You head into the marketplace, which is a sprawling open air section of town. There are gnomes and the penguin like Doar hawking wares from stalls, little kind of rickety wooden shops all over the place. It's pretty cacophonous. Because mm-hmm. there are also, in addition to that, there are many, many different machines moving and clanking and whistling and blowing steam and expelling smoke all over the place. And there's everything from, common goods, anything that you'd find in the player's handbook, to mm-hmm. tools, complex tools, large gnomish machines, more esoteric items that you really don't even know what they are just from glancing at them. There's a pretty big stall for preserved spaham.
Mm-hmm.
Delicious, delicious spaham.
And is there a door inside?
There are a few stalls. There's quite a few stalls of Doar merchants. You can just go up and ask one of them if you...
Yeah, I will go and ask one of them.
Okay. Oh. Yes, Laftel?
I buy a pearl while I'm in here. Well, I'm going to the market. Yeah, just a single pearl. All
right. 100 gold pieces or a different value?
No, just 100 gold pieces.
Okay.
If I trade a trade bar, I would lose 10%, or is it 5%?
I think it's 5%.
Alright.
So, Solas, you approach the nearest Doar and inform that you'd like to speak with one of their... one of the heads of their consortium about the beavers on the underside. And the Doar directs you to a... small office that you didn't really even see before because it's kind of behind a lot of stalls and a lot of gnomish machinery. He indicates that those are the current offices of the Doar Consortium.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead. Okay, so you make your way over there and find the building. You enter it, and there's about half a dozen penguin-like Doar at desks writing out what you'd guess are ledgers of some sort.
Mm-hmm.
And one up near the front greets you. Ah, yes, welcome to the Doar Consortium. How can I help you today?
Greetings, good sir. I came here to inquire about if you could help me in knowing the customs of the beavers that live on the other side of this planetoid.
Oh, we do not actually deal with them directly. They make purchases from us for various goods, but the gnomes act as intermediaries.
What do they usually purchase from you?
Oh, from us, it's typically tools, occasionally some jewelry, things of that nature, exotic textiles like cotton or linen.
Okay. Do you know anything about like where is their largest settlement or such?
I do not know for sure, but I believe that some of the gnome merchants that we deal with said that they tend to go to the there's a fairly good sized lake on the underside that you can find there a settlement pretty easily. As I understand it, the whole underside is fairly thickly forested, and it can be difficult to get ships into any of the other waterways.
I see. And could you tell me who these gnome merchants that work as your intermediaries are?
Oh, I'd like yes. To
learn about these beavers from them.
He directs you to some other gnomes who are out in the bazaar. They have an office off the kind of off the side, connected to the so like the building is outside of the open air market, but there's a door into it from the market.
Okay, well, I thank the door and mentioned that they compliment their business in here.
You see him preen with pride a bit, and he says, "Yes, of course, if you ever need quality merchandise from all throughout the known spheres, please do come our way. We guarantee cheaper prices than those arcane."
Of course, I will remember this. Thank you very much.
Okay. You also remember some of the warnings that sometimes they offer cheaper prices than the arcane, because the quality of the goods aren't always as good, or the provenance of the goods are not always as good.
Yeah. I know that.
All right, well, so you make your way to the gnomish merchant office?
Yeah.
Okay. Funnily enough, it looks very similar when you enter. There's about a dozen gnomes all sitting at desks filling out ledgers. And one of them greets you as you enter. "Yes, how can I help you? I'd be more than happy to deliver any goods to your ship if you need specific large quantities purchased. We have many fine goods. Anything out in the bazaar, we can get you easily."
Well, at the moment, I'm not in after of goods, but more of an information, and I heard that you might have it.
Oh, yes, we are happy to provide information, so long as it doesn't compete with our business interests.
Oh, no worries about this, because we are not looking for being merchants ourselves, but I hear that you make dealings with the beavers on the other side.
Indeed we do.
Could you tell me about the beavers, because my adventuring group is, we are heading that way and looking for some of the beavers and their knowledge.
He kind of gives you an odd look when you mention the beaver's knowledge, and he says, "Well, I don't know how much you'd be able to get. They're very good at providing quality wood, but they're not exactly very smart. They have no interest in steam power, coal power, or any other automated devices that would make their lives so much easier. They could cut down so many more trees if they used one of our tools rather than their teeth."
Of course, but the knowledge we are not after is not that kind of knowledge. It's more of a something else, not really a business or invention related. But I would be interested in if you could tell me about the beavers and what are their largest settlements in there.
Well, the...
And do you have a map of the other side?
We do not. We have not explored their land. They haven't been interested in any gnomish exploratory parties of any sort. Your best bet would be to just land in any one of their waterways, depending on the size of your ship. There are many different ones that you can get to. The beavers will likely come out to greet you and express interest in trading with you if you make it clear that you are peaceful. Although other than wood, they don't produce much that would be of interest.
And they usually buy tools and such from you.
Well, we are just intermediaries for most of it. Many of the things they purchase, they get from the Dowar. We are just the intermediaries.
I see. Do you know anything about their culture, so to speak, so as to know that what to do and what not to do? When talking to them.
Well, we really only speak to them on the for purchasing of wood products. Haven't really explored their culture very much. As I said, they're completely uninterested in any of the fantastic advanced devices that we create. And really, that kind of shows their lack of overall intelligence now, doesn't it?
Well, you could take it as that way. But I thank you for your help and bid you good rest of the day.
You have a good day as well.
And I leave.
All right.
And return to the ship.
Okay.
And relay what I got out of the...
All right. Anyone else have any thoughts on that?
Well, if beavers aren't very clever, I don't know how much study they will be making of the night sky.
You have to remember that it's the tinker gnomes that think about them like that.
Yeah.
So they are a bit biased.
That's true, but... Are they going to be able to identify something with an unusual light on it in the sky?
Well, that's why we should talk to them and find out. We can't just guess it from here.
Well, it could be a red herring from the carrot expert.
Well, we can check it out. It does. We're not going to get very far very fast with this other stuff.
Yeah. I mean, it's another thing to look at, but I don't think we should abandon everything else to go talk to beavers. If we have some people looking for that research material, and we have no other things to do, maybe we could pop over and talk to beavers.
Okay.
Well, Solas is at least interested in talking with the beavers.
All right.
For nothing else, because he hasn't heard of sentient beavers before.
Well, if we didn't have loads of wood, I might ask the beavers how good they are at making planks.
I mean, you can always ask them anyway, but...
Get a beaver carpenter.
That's true. I wonder if beavers provide discounts on wood.
Do you want to head over there right now, or do you want to like wait another day? Do spellcasters want to change up their spells anymore, or anything else? Like, what do you want to do now?
The spellcasters want to change their spells.
I've already changed mine.
Okay. As soon as the spellcasters are ready, I want to go over to the beaver side.
Okay. The ship. Is anyone staying, or does everyone want to go?
No.
We're all going, aren't we?
We're all going over to the beaver side.
Should I stay to keep an eye on the whole Tinker Gnome taking a look at the notes for me thing, or
if you would like?
If I ask,
she won't be doing it if you're not there, but. If you're there, then you're not on the other side and you can't give any assistance if it's needed. Or ideas or anything like that, so.
Okay, I'll go.
Okay. Everyone, you return to your ship. By the way, Ocker, so she was doing that research for 7 hours the night before, so that you can deduct that for her pay. And you pile onto the ship and take off, make your way to the other side. It so happens that, being the other side of the planet, it is late at night and coming up on morning as you do so. But the underside, the top side where the gnomes, is lots of cleared area. There's still some forests, but, you know, it's no more than maybe a third of the ground cover on that side. On the reverse side, almost the entire surface is a fairly dense forest. You can see the locations of rivers and streams, but most of them aren't particularly wide. You don't think that your ship would be able to get in there into any of those rivers, but there is a lake located to one side. It's not like near the center kind of thing, that you can land your vessel, has plenty of space.
All right, let's do that. Is that near one of the spots where we were told that the beavers would meet us?
Well, actually, I should say that there's a number of lakes, but that one's the largest. You kind of got the impression that the largest lake was a good place, but like the gnomes weren't exactly clear on that kind of thing.
Gotcha.
Is that where you want to put down?
All right, that sounds, yeah, let's sit down.
Okay.
It's at least place to start.
I'm looking this up unless I'm a bit quiet.
All right, so you you land. It is still nighttime. You probably have 2 hours before dawn sets in on this side, however.
Catch up on a bit of sleep for the people that didn't get a full night?
Yeah.
Probably.
You could definitely do so.
Yeah. Yeah. And if we're
Solas will stay on the deck.
Okay. As you land and you know, kind of set in to get some extra sleep and just wait for daylight to come, you do hear echoing across the lake some dull booming sounds. Not like loud, just kind of. You know, they're clearly sounds that are carrying.
Does it sound like trees falling down?
No. But after that, you don't hear anything else.
Could it be trouble?
I mean, it certainly could be. But, I mean, you got some crew on watch and stuff like that, so.
Brax is going to say to Higgins, maybe we should go investigate, see if they need our help.
You're not really sure where they came from. Like, the way that the sound carried, you can't pinpoint the location of where they came from. It could have been from one side, it could have been from the other, it could have been straight ahead, it could have been from behind you.
It's not really easy to locate the sound, place where the sound comes from when you are on open water and it's nighttime. But Solas will keep a lookout if there is anything that he could spot. Light sources or anything.
You really do not see much in the way of light, but it is also nighttime. As the sun begins to rise, you can see at the far end of the lake a line of something. A pile of something. It's hard to see from where you are, and there's also a bit of a early morning mist. It's like, kind of like stretching across the water. But the sun is beginning to rise. I assume that everyone is waking up.
Yes, I'll wake up with the sunrise.
Okay. What do you guys want to do?
Find
us a beaver.
Yeah, let's go see if we can find one of those, I guess, large beaver dams somewhere.
You gonna pull out your spyglass and look around?
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay. Using the spyglass, you realize that what you saw at the far end of the lake appears to be a pile of logs across the edge of the lake.
Oh. Okay, let's make our way kind of close to that, I guess. And then see if we can't get their attention.
Okay. As you you're basically sailing the shuttle down the lake.
Yes.
Okay. As you approach that, you hear some splashes and more of the dull booming sounds echoing across the lake. And after a couple minutes, you hear some voices from down the waterline by the boat. Shout out a warning. One says, "Halt your vessel."
All right, I'll give the cue to slow down. And then I'll greet the beavers.
Okay, looking over the edge, you do see that your ship is surrounded by at least a dozen beavers. These are... Higgamus, you've probably never actually seen a beaver. You've probably seen some beaver pelts. You've heard of them, but these are a lot bigger than the beaver pelts you've seen. These creatures are about 6 feet long in the water. And maybe not quite as big as a human, but similar mass. A couple of them do have some long wooden mallets in their paws, but they have they also have long front teeth that you think would be able to do quite a bit of damage to the hull of your ship if they wanted to. But with your greeting, the one that spoke speaks up to you. You are in our Empire's territory. What? You are not gnomes. What do you have? What issue do you have with coming here?
We came to talk. We were told that you were friendly. We did not know that we're in the middle of an empire.
They seem to talk amongst themselves, and the beaver turns back and says, "Have you spoken with the gnomes? They're the only ones who typically come here."
Yeah, we spoke to a gnome that recommended we come and talk to you.
We need to speak to the builders, and we're told that the beavers were the builders.
Well, we indeed are quite adept at building. If you wish to speak with a representative from the Empire's government, I suppose we could pass that along. It is certainly unusual that you would come here. The gnomes are good for getting some resources that we don't have an easy way of making, but they're not very bright. They're not interested in the fantastic wooden constructions that we do. We're kind of surprised that anyone else would be interested. But
Braxton leans over the side and says, "Well, I'm into carpentry, and I believe you're better at carpentry than I am."
Yes, well, that kind of goes to without saying, but if you will keep your vessel here, we will get a representative who can speak for us.
Sounds good.
By the way, what's that booming noise? I wondered if you needed some help.
Probably a tree falling.
Suddenly, his large flat tail lifts up out of the water and then slams back down. And as it hits the water, it releases a booming sound. And he says, "That's simply how we can communicate across long distances."
Wow. I do signaling as well. So you have a signaling system with your tails. Very clever.
Without another word, he kind of ducks beneath the water, and the other beavers also disappear from view. And they leave you to kind of sit and wait for a little while.
Mm-hmm.
After about 45 minutes or so, a wooden raft pulled by a few beavers comes out of the early morning fog that has thickened up a little bit. In the center of it, you see a giant beaver that has a mallet like some of the others did, but a bit more ornate, polished, and you think even varnished, and it seems to be wearing some sort of necklace or amulet around its neck and in its fur. The raft pulls up next to your dolphin shuttle, some wooden boards are pushed up against the edge of your ship, and the beaver scampers up onto your deck. The beaver is definitely bigger than a gnome in overall bulk and size, but not as tall as any of the humans in your party, or really even the elves, mainly just because it is kind of, you know, hunched over, and, you know, ready at any point, it seems like, to go on all fours. And the beaver looks over you all and then says,
I am a representative of the government. I was told that you wished to speak with someone. You needed some information, I think it was?
Yes, please. Solos, could you...
Yes, we are...
talk about the thing we need.
We have been following this poem that we got as a clue from Oracle, and the poem mentions that we should talk to the small builders on a piece of iron, for in night sky they see that which you seek aglow with another sun's shed. So from what we have learned, the small builders would suggest that it would be you beavers.
Could you repeat that poem for me?
A stony home of unwilling people you seek, lost long and taken from ruins debris. From forge to spiral has it fled. Small builders on a piece of iron must you speak. For in night sky there they see that which you seek aglow with another sun's shed.
And you think that we would know what this object you seek is?
Well, we think you might know where it is in the night sky. The object we are seeking is an old dwarven citadel?
We may. I would have to speak with other representatives of my government. The Castan Imperium, the Cambrus Imperium doesn't have much dealing with your kind, and such a request is obviously quite strange for us.
I understand.
Do you mind waiting while we discuss the matter?
Of course, and if there is something we could do for it, we are open for options.
She seems to look over your group, and then says,
"Very well, I will return as soon as I can with an answer. I am Verli. I am an official with the Imperium."
Thank you for seeing us.
She heads back down the ramp. The ramp is boards are pulled back to the raft, and the beavers then pull her back into the fog, which is quickly dissipating as the morning advances. You see, she's pretty clearly going to what you can now see is a large mound of kind of like it looks like just a pile of logs attached to this long line of piled up logs. As the raft gets close to it, you realize that it seems a bit bigger than you expected to. But she disappears amongst the big pile. And you're left to wait for a few hours. Is there anything that anyone wants to do in the meantime?
Well, Solas at least mentions that it seems that this clue might be the right one.
Any gully dwarves around? Have you seen any?
You have not seen any gully dwarves. There may have been some gully dwarves up on the other side. On the obverse of Iron Piece, but you also wouldn't recognize gully dwarves.
Oh, right, never mind.
Is there anywhere we can look around? Because we're kind of in the lake.
You're kind of in the middle of a lake, yes. You'd have to somewhere else to, you'd have to either get the ship closer to shore, swim, or if you have any sort of rowboat.
But we haven't been given permission to enter the...
They asked us to wait.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But if they do have the knowledge we seek, and if there is some favor they ask, perhaps after that we can establish lumber purchasing options from them. I think Braxton would be interested in.
We already purchased it with the...
for our future. Yeah, and for future.
Might be good for the future.
I mean, wood might be cheaper in here than it is in Braal.
So after afternoon has come, you guys have had a meal, and one of the lookouts calls down that raft appears to be making its way back to you from the Beaver Lodge, and you see on it what you think is the same beaver and another beaver as well. Mm-hmm. In addition to the beavers who are pulling along the raft. It pulls up next to the dolphin shuttle again, and the ramp is extended, and the two beavers clamber back up onto your deck. You do recognize that one of them is the beaver that appeared the first time, named Verli. And she speaks again and says, "We may know what you are looking for. I, without more information on what exactly you are looking for, I cannot say, and that is not information that I know personally. But if we are to assist you,
as was made the offer when I was here last, we would require some help from those more capable of certain tasks than we are.
Mm-hmm. Well, if help is what you require.
We have been plagued recently on some of our outlying one of our outlying areas by a horrid creature unlike anything we've seen before. We have been unable to fight it. The only way we've found to kill them is to even drown them. Our warriors are not the most skilled at fighting them off. Mostly we just have to deal with some of the large furry rejects from the gnomes. But they are generally not too difficult for our warriors to handle. These things, on the other hand, are a horrid creature unlike anything we've seen before.
Could you describe them to us?
She does, and it's weird. She describes them as small and beetle-like, but with fur as well.
Oh, they're not amber. Oh, no.
From the descriptions, none of you recognize it. I mean, you may have some guesses, but it doesn't match anything that you're immediately familiar with.
As a player knowledge, I'm guessing that it's one of the Tinker Gnomes crossbreeding ideas have been to breed hamster and beetle.
Well, you may find out. What were you asking, Braxton?
Is this something sentient or just a monster?
We do not know. They seem only interested in killing and eating. Whether they have any sort of intelligence of their own, they have not shown any interest in communication.
And it's there's more than one. There's a group of them.
Yes, we did flood a small bit of woodland, and that took care of one group that was attacking, but obviously we cannot do that, and we're not exactly sure where they come from.
What abilities do they have?
They kill and they eat. Acid? That's really it.
Okay. Right.
Just they shoot predator. Stuff, or...
How do they kill?
Well, they're like beetle-like, they tend to swarm, and I don't know much beyond that. I have not encountered them myself, but the reports that I've seen doesn't indicate that they're using any sort of weapons or anything like that.
Have you talked to the Tinker Gnomes, whether they may have let those go accidentally?
It's a fairly recent problem, and we only have contact with the Tinker Gnomes on a fairly regular basis of 3 times a year. They showed up after the last time they visited.
Okay.
How many?
Are they small?
Yes, they're not particularly large.
How many of them do you guess there are?
I have no idea.
Or how many places they have been sighted?
Well, they've only been sighted near one of our lodges. It's one of the more outlying lodges near the edge of the world. This young warrior, Kasten, here can guide you to them, to that lodge, and from there you may be able to find their source.
That would be helpful. Is it possible to take our ship near them, near that place?
She kind of looks over your ship and says,
"We can fly if there is water to land near it."
There's a lake, but the lodge is on a river. You'd need to take a raft down it. Kasten can direct you to the nearest lodge, from which you can take a raft.
We may not want this anyway, because if there are beetles and some of them enter the ship, what are we going to do then?
Well, it seems that they can't swim.
No, as far as we can tell, they cannot, which is probably one of the only reasons our lodge has not been overrun and they have not spread further. That area is in between two rivers.
Mm-hmm. So
what say our captain?
Yeah, let's do it. It seems like the best way to get the information we need.
Yeah. Will the beavers down there have more information on the current activities of these beagles?
They should, yes.
Sounds like a plan then.
Well, I think it would be best for us to then start heading that way.
Yeah.
Okay. You know what, one thing that I completely forgot to ask, is Yatla back on the dolphin, or she probably wouldn't have come down?
I didn't know whether she was going to carry on coming.
Yeah, we didn't know if she was going to come with us.
She hadn't made her mind up last time.
Right, that's right. I completely forgot that hadn't happened. She would have indicated that she would. I forgot that I hadn't done that I was going to have that until this session. And it completely slipped my mind. But I think that she would have stayed up on the dolphin itself, in part because when the dolphin shuttle is out, she has a lot more room to spread out.
Yeah.
Yeah, but then when we come back, we have to not land on top of her.
Well, no, it's pretty easy not to, though. But, on
the other hand, it could be very interesting for her to meet people even smaller than we are.
Yeah, but I mean, since I'd completely forgotten that she was, I was going to have her come with you if you wanted her to. She would have stayed up, being a little bit nervous about such a small group, and also, you know, I mean, there's a certain element of giant gnome and giant and dwarf hostility, so she would have been a little bit nervous about that.
Okay.
But if you do want her for this part, you can get back up to the ship and bring her down. That's something for you guys to think about for next time.
Yeah.
Okay. So the beaver Verly introduces you to the beaver next to her as Kasten, and he will guide you to the lodge. And we will do that next week.
Could you repeat the name?
Kasten. And her name is Verly.
Yeah, Verly I had, but...
Alright. So, experience points-wise, that is going to be... 500 for Leva, Laftel, and Ocker. 600 for Higamus, 700 for Solus, and 800 for Braxen.
Ooh.
And am I succeeding in not getting you guys to level up still?
Mm-hmm.
You got me really close, but...
After the fight, I probably will level.
A fight? Fight? What fight? I didn't say that there was going to be a fight.
So, it was 500?
It's going to be a slaughter.
Yeah.
Mm.
Okay.
68,000 to the next level. Oh, yay.
Yeah, a little ways. A little ways off. So, I want to thank you guys for...
I think I need, like, 91,000.
Yeah. I think if you're that far away, you could just say a lot.
Yeah. I need
too much.
I need basically 161 for my cleric.
1,000 or just points?
161.
Oh. Can we do something that he gets some now?
Nope.
I need less than 40,000.
Basically next level I will then, or next session I will get my level.
Ah, unless so little happens. Unless so little happens that there's just no experience that gives
out. I need about 2,000 for my priest. Over 2,000.
So that would be 4,000-ish.
Oh, no, that's... It only needs 1,000.
Oh, okay.
1,000, 100, gotcha. 228.
Well, we'll see if that comes your way next time.
It probably won't.
It's the closest I've been.
Optimism at its best.
So I want to thank you guys for playing. I want to thank everyone out there for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. And we will be back next week with more adventures in Arcane Space. With, well, maybe not more Tinker Gnomes, because I think that you've probably exhausted that part. Since now you're
out.
Talking with the giant beavers.
No, don't worry. We are going to return to the Tinker Gnomes just for your enjoyment.
I think we're
enjoyment.
Under for this. I think we need to find Guy.
Oh, and there might be more fun stuff coming next week, too.
What can be better than Tinker Gnomes and Talking Beavers?
Oh, just wait. See you next time, everyone.
Wait.
Bye.
Oh, okay. No.